This event, and thanks to Eric at Bird and Beckett for staging this event. And the event was supposed to be mostly musical, but then it morphed into a reading because my book came out, maybe unexpectedly, my most recent book, which is speculative fiction. So I'll read a little excerpt from that, and Ava will continue to be up here with me for that. So just a little bit of backstory. It's a science fantasy of the far future. All the characters are post-human, which turns out to be my sweet spot for making characters. So this story takes place on a new celestial body in our solar system, Ocean One. And that body has been generated by the close brush-up of a neighboring brain, B-R-A-N-E, if you know about brain cosmology, that caused a ripple effect in our cosmos, in our solar system, and maybe created this weird spin-off of Earth called Ocean One. All right, so that's the setting. What else? Oh, Mu, Her name is spelled M-O-O, and she has a sister, V-O-O, who's mentioned. And Mu is the species that she belongs to is the delphins, and that's a synthesis of elfin humans and dolphins, so delphins, as a future bypath of evolution. But they are native to this strange Ocean One planetoid that has appeared in our solar system. And this is like a million years in the future. So Mu is a bit of an outlaw, and she's left her city to investigate this gigantic mile-long wreck of a spaceship that seems to have crashed into Ocean One like a million years ago. And Mu calls the wreck a space whale because it exhibits petrified biological as well as technological features. So this is that scene where Mu is exploring the space whale. The planetoid Ocean One, in violation of the laws of physics, was nothing but a single drop of water orbiting the sun. Watery, down to its very core, Mu, the young delphin, recited the lesson obsessively, for it provided a picture of her soul today. Watery, down to its very core. The lesson on water continued. If one is incapable of holding any shape, then one is empty. What was wrong with this reasoning? Mu had committed mirror assassination, the worst crime imaginable. The crime left no evidence but an empty mirror. Now she too felt herself to be empty, a predictable consequence, and forever alienated from the society of delphins, swarming in their millions through the warrens of Asia, a spherical mountain that rolled in the depths of Ocean One. She had committed the crime without premeditation. Indeed, the crime could only be a spontaneous act, carried out in a flash of blindsight. Yet, in retrospect, she knew with certainty that she had intended to do it. How, she wondered as she swam into the ancient wreck known as Space Whale, could an act be both spontaneous and intentional? The gigantic carcass had become her place of refuge, away from the constant bloom and zoom of the Delphin City. She had come here often in the days leading up to the crime, to meditate, she had told herself, to receive messages from the origin of the world. Mu had, to the mild disapproval of her family, become fascinated by the ancestral trash caught up in the wake of Asia. The greatest relic of them all was Space Whale. What message had she received from it? Along the interior walls of Space Whale, fingers of iridescence followed Mu, always falling short of her shadow as it crept over the technoid outcroppings. Mu was not afraid, having become accustomed to conditions inside the relic. Who, she called softly, who? In the aftermath of her crime, it comforted her to invoke the name of the first delphin to step out of his own reflection. Who, of course, could not protect her now. She would be pursued. The symmetry keepers would know where to find her. Mu slipped easily through the dear old petrified bones. She imagined herself to be Space Whale, alive and plunging through faraway red nebulae. Mu had never seen the stars. She had never swum to the surface to breach that utterly smooth, waveless ceiling and gaze for one freezing instant at the sun. Those who had done so, scientists and mystics for the most part, returned with their faces blackened, spiritual light spilling from their mouths. It was not a crime to breach the surface, to witness the wheels of heaven, to confirm what was already attested in the sacred records, was to uphold the shimmering O whose mirror face was zero. Who said that? Only the violation of symmetry was a crime. Because of Mu's rash deed, one of heaven's wheels was missing now. Mu felt its absence, even here, inside the beloved carcass of Space Whale. They would find her here. They would take her back to Asia, imprison her, gently but without forgiveness, in a tesseract. Desperately, she sought some small item, some souvenir of Space Whale, that could keep her company, succor her as she languished for a lifetime in that cell. But this mile-long tunnel contained nothing but the remnants of life machinery. There, what was that? A shiny orb lodged in a crevice. She pried it loose. It fit perfectly in the palm of her hand. It weighed almost nothing, but felt heavy nonetheless. It had somehow escaped petrifaction. She clutched the orb to her chest, as if Space Whale had gifted it to her. Best to leave now, return to the city. Mu did not want the symmetry keepers to break into Space Whale in order to apprehend her. The relic's interior had become identical to Mu's own, a thought cavern where she concocted stories without characters or events. She did not wish to see this place invaded by the police. Mu waited, as usual, for the fingers of iridescence to point outward, to point toward an exit, never the same one. This time they showed her a spiral-shaped sphincter near the head of the relic. "Thank you," she whispered, worming her way out, out, out into the world ocean and all the wild wave action of Asia's detritus trail. Mu clung to Space Whale's hull for a moment. Ocean was warm and good to breathe after the stale effluvium trapped in the carcass's entrails. Daylight filtered down from surface, dappling the hull. Miles ahead rolled the great round rock of Asia, home of Delphin humanity. A played-out utopia, a prison house for Mu. Why not seek refuge in one of the other great rocks? America, Africa, Ost, or Arctica. They were all uninhabited now. But she would have to journey far to reach them, and she would probably die of starvation along the way. Besides, the scent of her crime, like the taste of Space Whale's effluvium, lingered in her. She wanted to purge herself of her own poison, make an obscene bubble of it that would explode in the face of her captors. Perhaps she needed to take other actions, corollary to the crime. Mu pushed herself away from Space Whale's pitted and corroded body. She needed to dive sideways, tacking across the turbulence of the wake toward stiller water. Carrying the orb, she swam awkwardly. Its weight, or lack of weight, steered her the wrong way. In fact, it seemed to be pulling her deeper than she wanted to go. As Mu struggled with it, she realized she had already passed beyond the wake more quickly than usual, thanks to the orb. Now, in calmer currents, the orb, as if sensing her intent, veered back toward the rolling rock of Asia. What a strange device she'd plucked from the innards of Space Whale. It was helping her to get back to Asia in half the usual time. Yet no delight or wonder stirred in her, only a grim, gray gratitude. Once she entered the city, she would seek out the symmetry keepers, surrender herself to them. Why not? She had cut herself off from the rest of humanity. Nothing mattered now. Yes, it was all that mattered, this new vacancy, this lack of feeling she felt inside her. She would sit on the floor of her cell, the orb placed before her, and think upon nothing. Mu had lost the precepts, the guides to good action that she was born with. She had always known that they were poorly formulated, even fallacious when set against the night of time. Rather than devise a better set of precepts, she preferred to have none. She remembered the day she'd first emerged, fully formed, along with all her sisters, Lu, Su, Fu, Ru, Bu, in the room of birth mirrors. She remembered crying with them, not again, never again, but a voice, a wavering presence within their mirrors. Who? Who? Showed the little brood of sisters how to overcome this primary aversion. All of them were reconciled to re-existence, all except Mu. Not long after, her sisters went hoo-hoo-hooing through the corridors of Asia, ready to assume their positions in society. Only Mu hung back, lingering near her birth mirror. She had emerged at a different angle, a fallen angle. She could have been a child, a type of unformed human that no longer existed, but a child cognizant of the history of the world and wanting to play dangerously with it. Hu said, "Don't." But his voice must be, she reasoned deviously, mirror reversed. So Mu heard, "Do, Mu," and also, "Doom." She was shaken from her reverie by a downward yank of the orb. She was nearing home, close enough that the city no longer looked spherical, but flat. Below her spread a landscape of wells and windows. She heard the groan, the ground tone of Asia's progress through the waters. Once more she had to battle turbulence, her sleek, naked delphin body slicing artfully through the heavy waves. It was likely that she would never again swim freely in ocean. She didn't care. Mu grabbed a handhold next to a public window. The window's membrane knew her as delphin and allowed her to slip inside. That was perfect. Okay, we are going to take a short break, and then we're going to come back for Evidence Trio. Yeah. And for our last number, Ava's going to rejoin us up
Yay.
Here.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah.
Yes.
Like, in fact, I said this.
Or is that? Has it ever?
So we're actually
So I'll need to set levels for the three before we actually start. Give me 1 minute, I'm bringing up the sale.
Okay, we're attentive though, Eric.
Hang on, did you see what he picked up?
Just a sound check, you guys.
We're so excited.
So I need your help. I need the cable coming from your mic.
All right. Let's find that blue cable.
It's going into one. So you're plugged in.
All right.
Your cable here, that's the blue, the gray. Where is it? Oh, that's what's plugged in. So yours with the blue on this end. We need to follow that.
It's under your bag. All right. Let's find that.
That's the cable, and I need the end of it.
Is the end over here? Is the end
probably tucked under something?
Jeez.
Okay.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Now I'm going to go back and mute things before I plug these in. This is the right thing.
Where's the end of it?
The end of it. We'll never see the end of it.
I know. Really? It's a paradox.
Yeah.
Look how much cable I've got for just going about 4 feet.
It's spaghetti, and I don't even see the end of it.
Isn't that odd? Oh, it's up there, looped over that.
Oh, there it is.
Looped up here, up high. So don't plug. You can plug it in. I'm gonna go mute it before I plug it in here. And then I want that to come up my way.
Can I ferry something over?
All right. And maybe sort of along the wall instead of in front of you.
Yeah. Okay. I'll put it over there.
Do I have the end? We'll never see the end of this either.
It's all about electricity and its conduits.
Uh-huh.
All right.
So I have a cable. We don't know which end is the. Which end is this one?
This is going to the amp, Eric.
There we go. Okay. So I'm going to go mute these two channels and plug these in, and then the people in the stream will hear those instruments.
So is the stream going to get the sense of my just plain sax without the effects as well?
It's only going to get that. So you would you rather have? I could put another mic up. I can put two mics up for you.
Okay. I mean, the other thing is I was thinking I could just pull this back a little.
I can put two mics up for you. I need a mic stand, which is that one right there that's free.
Okay,
I'm going to get a clip and a cord and a mic.
All right.
All right, stand by, ladies and gentlemen. This is art in action.
And I'm coming from, you know, and it's so hot. Is it hot? It's so fucking hot. Yeah, it's dry hot. So there's no rest of it. And when does that sleep? You know, I have no idea. Is it like when gray season?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, it's four seasons.
But it's hot, and it's really hot.
Poor
really complicated way the first time I do it. Even my mom that has green card this time, they gave her a hard time because you have to come and leave here.
Thomas. Yeah, he does. He does. The red one. How's that?
Excuse me, folks. So, you got it out.
It's going right in there. There's no reason. Okay, there's no real reason. I might mic that directly for not getting any camera.
I'll give you a signal. I'll scream. It's too much information.
You want some theremin, Eric? Okay.
This is Evidence Trio, right? There comes Thomas at the back, Andrew Joron on theremin, Kersti Abrams on saxophone and flute. Thomas, now I lost it, sorry.
Harrison.
Yeah.
I was so close.
You were close.
Thomas,
you're
Harrison
so good, Eric.
Bass, yeah. And Ava Koohbor is going to join them on the
yes, that's
going to
happen. That's
going to
happen.
There's an announcement, Mike, for you to use if you like.
Okay.
I'm going to go back up that to that end.
Is it live?
Sounds like it's not up yet.
No.
When I get to that end,
okay.
I'll turn it up.
All right.
We actually will pay the musicians at the end of the day fairly substantially by my standards, so if you can adhere to a $20 cover, it will help us get closer to that. If you can't do a $20 cover, give me what you can. If you can do a $75 cover, I will accept it. I'm not proud.
Yeah.
Okay, that's about it. I'll get out of the way. I'll turn that up, and I think you guys can go.
Okay.
Okay.
We're ready.
Test, test. Okay. All right. Hi, everybody. We're back. This is Evidence Trio. We're going to continue it in to go into the outer zone. But we want to dedicate our set to the memory of Tom Nunn, an experimental musician and instrument maker, instrument inventor, very amazing, magical, marvelous guy who passed unexpectedly a couple of weeks ago and kind of, you know, has been upsetting for many of us in the music community. So anyway, we're dedicating our set to him. And yeah, search Tom Nunn, Tom N-U-N-N, and you'll find some interesting sound phenomena. All right. So I don't, the... We're through here with the mic.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. your breath for a minute.
Thank you.
and then Ava's coming up. Thanks for your presence and your ears and your, yeah, everything.
Thank you. Guys, if you could see Ava's console here, it's just like a maze of blinking lights and switches. I don't know how she finds her way around inside of it. Thank you.
From our seats, just like stopped us.
Hopefully.